Hi everybody, I hope you're well. Today I will read from a book titled Berlin Maps by Sebastian Felix Ernst and Jonas Stratz, published by Ruby Press.
Berlin is a city of singularities. This applies equally to the densely populated core city and the wider metropolitan area, where the city encounters its surrounding countryside. In just one century, Berlin has undergone a series of fundamental transformations marked by incredible growth, destruction, and a subsequent phase of survival as a Siamese twin city. This last formative phase was characterized by stagnation or even shrinkage, strengthening Berlin's already unusual polycentric settlement form, which is characterized by the absence of a clear core. These changing dynamics of antagonistic political forces forged a variety of spatial characteristics and abnormalities. Today, particularly on the outskirts of the city, these haven't yet been transformed, so they offer the potential for preservation and further development. With the increasing densification of Berlin's inner areas, it is logical that the outer city and para-urban spaces should get more attention as Berlin is growing, almost unnoticed, at a rapid pace. Because these outer areas still appear only tentatively in today's urban discourse, we propose a reversal, giving the periphery more attention, because the qualities of Berlin as a city only reveal themselves in its entire settlement area, in the interplay between dense urban realms and the nearly utopian natural reserves in direct proximity. Only those who also consider and understand the border area between Berlin and Brandenburg as a distinct space will discover the incredible hidden potential and opportunities for intelligent growth. Is there an Arcadian idea in Berlin's surrounding area? If Arcadia is understood as a balanced coexistence of landscape and culture, an idealized state, then perhaps the Potsdam cultural landscape curated over centuries comes to mind first. Defined panoramas, designed and staggered views along the Havel with frequent accents of buildings and artificial ruins. Yet, if one looks at the rest of the area surrounding Berlin without exaggerated expectations but rather with a curious eye, it's not hard to find many places where the landscape and architecture exhibit a similarly ambiguous interaction. Approaching this surrounding region, often perceived as a blank spot on the map, without prejudice and as uncharted territory, reveals something astonishing. The outskirts of Berlin are not suburban according to the American model, neither a territory of non-existing urban intensity nor a place defined by an absence of nature. Rather, the area around Berlin resembles a string of pearls made up of characteristic situations, some man-made and some natural. Mapping and exploring Berlin's surroundings along the political border with Brandenburg, one discovers microcosms and unexpected situations. There's a wealth of very different places, but not a uniform, homogeneous suburb that could be described by simple generic rules. There are expansive forests in the east and west, green neighborhoods, moors and swamps along the former inner German border strip, unusual urban phenomena such as escape tunnels and the exclaves outside the former western zone, or the landscape of the southern fringe with artificial mountains and the glacially formed Mugelberge. Berlin is extremely rich in themes and stories even far beyond its borders. In fact, the city's surrounding area doesn't offer just a single Arcadian landscape, but an almost countless number. The cartography of all these spatial cases shows the border area as a distinct place, as a diverse resource of narratives and ways of life. One could make the case that today it's much richer than the now thoroughly gentrified and homogeneous center. This unrecognized outer city ring, equally composed of buildings, infrastructure, and landscape forms, often goes unnoticed in another dimension, the scope and range of the urban and spatial planning debate. While Berlin's inner city has been planned, organized, structured, and administered for more than three centuries, the hinterland is not anarchic or untouched by legislative constraints, but is still a partially self-governed and loosely administered space. After the war with the inner German frontier, and today divided by Germany's federal structure, the border region of neighboring districts of Berlin and Brandenburg municipalities sometimes have as many as five responsible urban planning and building authorities within just a few kilometers. The star-shaped structure grows into Brandenburg, the federal state that surrounds Berlin, meaning that the city's border area, already part of the urban area economically and in the everyday lives of its inhabitants, is subdivided and administered by a vast number of different municipalities and districts. While this situation has allowed for a degree of diversity, it is now increasingly becoming a structural threat, as the important spatial bonds between Berlin and its surrounding areas and natural spaces could be largely dissipated due to the lack of any coherent vision. The single-family home with its own garden remains a desirable residential model for Germans. More than 100,000 new single-family abodes are built in Germany every year. Given the rising rents in central Berlin, the attractiveness of even the most remote areas of the city is increasing all the time. Berlin is growing octopus-like along the road and rail networks of the periphery. Municipalities are zoning areas to meet the demand for buildable land, just as the compact city seems more necessary than ever for sustainability reasons. Within this questionable parcel-based corset of settlements, largely inflexible, often poorly constructed buildings are erected with a useful lifespan that often lasts only until the children move out. To counteract this fatal development, the Umstadt, the ring of green, natural and settlement areas outside the core city, requires special protection and critical consideration of its utilization of space. These neighborhoods must be reassessed in terms of their potential for densification, sustainability and resilience with new, more community-oriented models of life and architecture. Many neighborhoods offer latent potential for these concepts, which can be nurtured in the context of site-oriented urban development. How can one imagine an urban Arcadia, a new Greater Berlin, highly dense yet green and sustainable? How can the periphery of the city grow into livable, differentiated urban areas and social neighborhoods that consciously embrace qualities different from the existing model of metropolitan city centers? Could the idea of an ideal landscape in which man and nature exist in balance be fulfilled in Berlin's para-urban spaces? Wouldn't this Arcadia be an amalgam of landscape and the necessities of the city? Density, mobility, and programmatic diversity? These and other questions have led us to embark on an expedition into what seems familiar, and to take a second look at nearby spaces that are invisible from the inner city and risk disappearing. With this atlas, we provide a double inventory, a mirror image, an unfamiliar view of a Berlin that existed or already exists, and a look at a Berlin that might still come to existence. We hope that this atlas will spark new views of this wonderful and multifaceted city. Whether the reader has a background in planning or design, or just plain interest, we hope to arouse curiosity. What is the shape of the city that I live and work in, or which I perhaps only visit, and how has it developed? How do we imagine its future? To inspire us to dream of a Berlin of tomorrow, we consider what people might think in 50 years and what we will look back on. To achieve a holistic and less object-focused view, an urban planning in which space is seen not only as materialized architecture but also as a complex habitat, we do not want to look at our themes in isolation and in an overly subject-specific way. Just like an atlas in elementary school education, this book should enable everyone to discover new territorial relationships. We consider natural landscapes, man-made structures, and legislative situations as equal forces in our built environment. We try to capture them in the plans and drawings of this book and make them tangible.
Ask for the book at your local bookstore. Thank you for joining me today, and see you in the next video. Bye.